comes at a price. And tonight, WWF Champion Hulk Hogan may have to pay the ultimate price. Thanks for tuning in to another special episode of Tyler Vance Rants. I am your host, Tyler Vance himself, and you're not. It's February 16th, 1985, and it is the kickoff to the World Wrestling Federation's war to settle the score. Similar to the brawl to end it all last July, this event is held in Madison Square Garden in the heart of New York City, USA, and will also be partially broadcast on MTV. The Rock and Wrestling connection is in full swing. While only the main event will be shown on MTV, the entire card will be shown on TVR. So let's jump right into the action. Moondog Spot takes on Quick Draw Rick McGraw in singles competition while Mean Gene Okerlund and Gorilla Monsoon provide commentary. A feeling out process starts the match off until McGraw is able to hit a shoulder block into a crossbody on Spot, which sees the Moondog attempt to fight back but misses an elbow. This opens the way for Rick McGraw to employ a dropkick on his opponent. Nothing Moondog Spot thinks of seems to outwit Quick Draw, who catches the Moondog coming off of the ropes in a tremendous display of physical strength in the form of a body slam. McGraw then tries to go for a hold, however Spot sees an opening and hits a reverse atomic drop to turn the tide of the match in his favor. Rick McGraw retaliates with several quick jabs to the face of Moondog Spot, right in plain view of the referee, who does absolutely nothing. However, Spot proves that he's no pushover with a shoulder breaker. A foot on the bottom rope is all that saves Quick Draw from a quick end. A nasty backbreaker on McGraw from Spot follows, and I'm genuinely surprised that Quick Draw was able to get up from it. He did though, and he suffers more for it as his opponent throws him through the ropes and down onto the floor. The bad luck continues for Rick McGraw as Moondog Spot follows him outside and slams Quick Draw into the guardrail. Once Rick McGraw and Moondog Spot are back inside the squared circle, the Moondog misses a splash in the corner, which leads to Quick Draw Rick McGraw taking advantage of the situation by tangling Spot up. A thunderous suplex from McGraw follows on Spot, who manages to kick out just at the last moment before going on to hit a gutbuster on Quick Draw. It's at this point that Moondog Spot makes a fatal error as he heads up to the top rope. Rick McGraw got his nickname Quick Draw for a reason, as he's already up to his feet, catching the Moondog and tossing Spot down to the mat.
One, two,
no,
wait a minute,
no, no,
wait a minute,
no,
we
no.
Get a bell.
Time limit has expired.
Not so quick on the draw after all, eh, McGraw? Johnny Rods faces off against Jose Luis Rivera in one-on-one competition next. And as the match begins, the two competitors jockey for position, with Johnny Rods being the one to come out on top with a wrist lock. Rivera manages to respond with two shoulder blocks before latching on a lengthy headlock. Fighting out of it, Rods catches Rivera in the midsection, knocking the Puerto Rican over before Johnny Rods gives him a taste of his boot. The unpredictable Johnny Rods then heads up to the second rope and drops an elbow onto Jose Luis Rivera's head. Rivera subsequently dodges another elbow from Rods seconds later before going on to Irish whip Johnny Rods so hard into the corner that Rods bounces around like a rag doll. The Puerto Rican goes on to issue out a tremendous amount of damage to the unpredictable one. However, the Puerto Rican star is never able to get anything more than a two count before Johnny Rods fights back with a boot to the face. A single punch from Rods follows, which sees Rivera tumbling through the ropes and down onto the floor. As Jose Luis Rivera attempts to re-enter the ring, Johnny Rods attempts a baseball slide, but only ends up crotching himself on the ropes instead. Instead of capitalizing on Rods' mistake though, Rivera tries to be flashy, pandering to the crowd as he heads to the second rope and tries an elbow of his own, but only ends up crashing and burning. All Johnny Rods has to do from there is drop a headbutt down onto the Puerto Rican, whose fate is sealed with a three count. More singles action follows as Rene Goulet takes on Hillbilly Jim, and even Mean Gene Okerlund calls out the Hillbillies' ridiculous choice of wrestling attire.
Rather unorthodox gear,
to say the least,
to go into the ring with.
Hey, check it out, it's famous weirdo Andy Warhol. Oh, and look, it's Danny DeVito and Joe Piscopo. For once, Cyndi Lauper wasn't lying when she said the celebrities would be out in force for the war to settle the score. Once the bell rings, Hillbilly Jim offers his hand in a gesture of sportsmanship. I wouldn't touch that if I were you, Goulet. You don't know where that freak's hand has been. Thankfully, the Frenchman takes my advice, but Jim takes personal offense at the gesture and chases Goulet out of the ring. Once back inside the squared circle, Rene Goulet develops second thoughts about competing against Hillbilly Jim as he suffers a shoulder block courtesy of Big Jim from Kentucky. Jim then places Goulet into a headlock despite the fact that the Frenchman is on the ropes. Instead of doing his job, the referee instead chooses to beg and plead with Hillbilly Jim to release Rene Goulet, who literally drops the Frenchman onto the mat before celebrating with a cartwheel like some kind of goof. Since Hillbilly Jim is fighting dirty, Rene Goulet fights dirty as well with a mixture of punches and bites, which infuriates the Hillbilly so much that he smashes his skull into Goulet's. Rene Goulet goes up to the top rope for a desperation move, but he gets caught on the way down by Hillbilly Jim, submitting in no time to the Hillbilly's bear hug. As if to make matters worse, some buffoon of a fan at ringside has decided to get lippy with Rene Goulet following the Frenchman's loss. Who is this clown? Whoa, you can't jump the rail. Security, security! The WWF Women's Championship is on the line next, as Leilani Kai, who's accompanied by former WWF Women's Champion in her own right, the Fabulous Moolah, looks to dethrone the champion, Wendi Richter, who's accompanied by pop star Cyndi Lauper.
Dave Wolf, if he'd be kind enough just to sit in.
You're ready.
I guess.
You're ready.
Ugh. If it weren't for you people, I'd have watched this match on mute to save my ears from bleeding at the sound of Naven Wolf's nasally voice. An altercation breaks out prior to the match even starting as Kai strangles Richter with her own coat. It seems to me that the Fabulous Moolah has prepared her protege very well. With the match properly underway, Leilani Kai continues to rub salt into Wendi Richter's wounds, standing on the WWF Women's Champion's hand before Richter fights out of it with a body slam and a leg drop, getting a near fall.
The opening moments have not, of course, certainly gone the direction that this lady would like.
Richter follows it up with a splash and a suplex, but still only gets two. The WWF Women's Champion proceeds to then tie the challenger up in the corner and proceeds to drive a gut into Leilani Kai's midsection. But as Wendi Richter goes for a second one, Kai frees herself, resulting in Richter's shoulder meeting the ring post. Leilani Kai hits a double underhook suplex and then a snapmare into a leg drop on Wendi Richter, who moments later moves out of the way as Kai attempts to tackle the WWF Women's Champion in the ropes. Even the Fabulous Moolah is concerned at that and checks on her client, who thankfully is well enough to continue the match. Wendi Richter brings her challenger back into the ring the hard way via suplex, but again, only gets a near fall. The WWF Women's Champion then attempts to put Kai into a surfboard submission, but can't quite get it locked in. And despite standing next to Richter, the blind referee doesn't notice that she has her shoulders down on the mat. Count to three, dummy! Mistakes can be costly, as Rene Goulet found out earlier. Unfortunately, Wendi Richter must not have been paying attention to Goulet's failures, as she releases the surfboard submission, resulting in Leilani Kai hitting her in the face with a boot seconds later.
Break her neck, Leilani!
Don't count Wendi Richter out yet, however. She is the WWF's number one woman for a reason, and she fights back with a clothesline and a massive boot to Leilani Kai's face. The pin is only broken as Kai gets a foot on the rope. Wendy Richter body slams Leilani Kai, but just as she does, Cyndi Lauper tries to antagonize the fabulous Moolah. So Moolah shows the pop star how she really feels about her. Break her neck, Moolah! The WWF Women's Champion makes yet another mistake, as she chooses to focus on rescuing her manager rather than finish her challenger off. So as the fabulous Moolah jabs her hand into Richter's throat, all Leilani Kai has to do is roll her up, and ladies and gentlemen, we have a new WWF Women's Champion. Despite the terrible sportsmanship from both Wendy Richter and Cyndi Lauper following the match, it's clear to see that the fabulous Moolah won her battle in the war to settle the score. David Sammartino is up against the other Moondog, Rex, in singles action next. And as the match gets underway, Moondog Rex hesitates as David Sammartino hits him with a hip toss. Moondog Rex then applies a more cautious approach before applying a bear hug on Sammartino.
There's a little beef in that ring right now, I don't mind telling you.
Where's the beef? In the ring. David Sammartino manages to break free of Moondog Rex's bear hug with an elbow before going to work on his opponent with several punches. A back suplex could have spelt doom for the Moondog, however Rex was close enough to the ropes to force a break. Once back to his feet, Moondog Rex subsequently drapes Bruno Sammartino's son over the top rope neck first, before hitting Sammartino in the back and sending David crashing and burning to the ringside area. David Sammartino re-enters the squared circle with a bloody nose, so Rex hones in on it like a shark at a feeding frenzy with several jabs. This enrages Sammartino, who fights back with punches of his own, culminating in a devastating uppercut. A power slam seconds later secures David Sammartino the win. More singles action follows as classy Freddie Blassie's client Nikolai Volkoff faces off against Swede Hansen next. Hansen not only carries a Confederate flag, but waves it proudly, while the animals in the crowd have the audacity to boo a Russian man as he attempts to sing his country's national anthem. Make it make sense. Swede Hansen is strong, and he's strong enough to shove Nikolai Volkoff so hard that the Russian tumbles down to the floor. Back in the ring, Volkoff goes to town with several punches on Hansen's midsection before the inevitable
chant goes out.
Chants ring out throughout Madison Square Garden, but even that is not enough to disrupt the beatdown being delivered to the American courtesy of the Russian. Nikolai Volkoff attempts to lift Swede Hansen up for his massive backbreaker, but doesn't quite have the strength left after exerting himself so much with this match, so he instead opts to slam Hansen down to the mat for the three. It's more one-on-one action next, as Rowdy Roddy Piper's right-hand man, Cowboy Bob Orton, takes on Hot Rod's longtime nemesis, Jimmy Superfly Snuka. Snuka starts the match by whipping Orton into the corner so hard that the Cowboy hangs helplessly from the top rope. The Superfly then kicks his opponent so hard that Orton ends up getting crotched. After recovering somewhat, Bob Orton and Jimmy Snuka crisscross with one another, but the Superfly is so enamored with demonstrating his athletic ability to the crowd that he forgets to actually perform a move on the Cowboy, who slides safely outside of the ring. What an idiot Jimmy Snuka is. Despite his lack of intelligence, Snuka gives in to his primal rage and chases Ace down, catching him with a chop before issuing an atomic drop to the bodyguard. This causes Bob Orton to retreat yet again to the outside of the ring, catching his breath before re-entering the squared circle and hitting Superfly with an atomic drop of his own. Cowboy Bob Orton goes up to the top rope and attempts to mimic Jimmy Superfly Snuka's diving splash, but meets Snuka's knees instead. Snuka then goes to the second rope and attempts to hit a diving headbutt, but Cowboy Bob Orton still has enough ring sense to roll out of the way. Despite this, Jimmy Snuka keeps the offensive up and manages to throw Cowboy Bob Orton into the corner where Ace's arm meets the ring post. For the rest of the match, Bob Orton holds this area of his body tenderly, and I honestly fear that he may have been injured by that maniac Snuka, who takes advantage of his opponent's weakness with a surprise sunset flip win. You should be ashamed of yourself, Jimmy Snuka. But then again, I don't think you have the intellectual capacity to know what shame feels like. Late in 1984, Mr. Wonderful and Mr. USA Tony Atlas competed in a pose down on TNT, where Vince McMahon revealed his bias as McMahon announced Atlas as the winner. Justifiably outraged by this, Mr. Wonderful attacked Mr. USA, and tonight we finally get to put the matter of who's better to rest.
It's Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff.
Look at Tony Atlas pandering to the crowd with his Cyndi Lauper female masturbation shirt. Along with his chrome dome, Mr. USA Tony Atlas makes Andy Warhol look normal. The meathead even physically puts his hands on the referee, moving him out of the way, which should have immediately resulted in a disqualification before the match even got underway. Here come the...
Now that's it, that new look for Tony Atlas.
...chance, infuriating Paul Orndorff so much that Tony Atlas is able to take advantage of it with an atomic drop and a suplex once the bell rings. Atlas then lifts Orndorff up and places him in the corner. Is this some kind of a joke? Mr. Wonderful isn't impressed, and neither am I. So Paul Orndorff slams Mr. USA Tony Atlas's head into the turnbuckle. But Paul Orndorff is forced to back away for his own safety as Tony Atlas simply smiles. Right, there's nothing in that head of his to hurt. How silly of me to think otherwise. As the referee attempts to separate the two competitors in the ropes, Paul Orndorff manages to get a blow in on Tony Atlas, which then results in Mr. Wonderful unloading on his opponent. But Mr. USA is somehow able to fire back with punches of his own and then goes on to hit a pile driver, Mr. Wonderful's own finisher. Tony Atlas goes to the well one too many times though, as Paul Orndorff is able to easily reverse a second pile driver attempt. Clearly, it's the referee's fault, so while Mr. USA is busy jawjacking, Mr. Wonderful simply rolls him up for the 1, 2, 3. Cope, Steve, mauled. Are you tired of singles matches by now? Well, Vince McMahon has heard you as he's booked the WWF Tag Team Championships to be on the line next. The Assassin, not to be confused with Assassin number 1 in Mid-Atlantic Championship Wrestling, and the Spoiler team up to face off against the American Express, managed by Captain Loser Albano, Barry Windham, and Mike Rotundo, who starts the match off for his team and catches the Assassin with 2 drop kicks. Windham then gets the tag and immediately puts the Assassin away with a bulldog. Hell, even I'll admit, that was impressive. I hope you enjoyed your tag team action while it lasted, because it's back to one-on-one competition next, as Mr. Italy Salvatore Bellomo takes on the Magnificent Morocco, who's brought his manager Mr. Fuji with him. Bellomo gets an early hip toss on the Magnificent One, but then bows to him like some sort of clown. Well, if the clown shoes fit, I guess. The Magnificent Morocco whips Salvatore Bellomo into the corner. Mr. Italy tries to rebound out of it with a cross body, however the Magnificent One turns it into a spine buster. A tombstone pile driver is the exclamation point to the Magnificent Morocco's victory. Many battles have been fought up until this point, but this final one will decide the outcome of the war to settle the score. A bagpipe brigade plays Scotland the Brave as Rowdy Roddy Piper makes his way to the ring.
Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, the war to settle the score.
Cowboy Bob Orton is with him, and my worst fears are confirmed. Ace was injured at the hands of that barbarian Jimmy Superfly Snuka. Justice will come for you, Snuka, and this time it'll be more than just a coconut.
Play-by-play announcer for Major League Baseball, Mr. Bob Costas.
Bob Costas? Who the hell is Bob Costas? The WWF Champion, Hulk Hogan, makes his way down to the ring flanked by that she-bopper, Cyndi Lauper. Is anyone else getting secondhand embarrassment? Or is it just me? My grievances, with the Hulkster aside, His popularity with the animals in the crowd is insurmountable, as they are so loud throughout Madison Square Garden that I can't even hear Mean Gene Okerlund and Gorilla Monsoon on commentary. At the sound of the bell, the two competitors go at it in a flurry of fists, with Hulk Hogan being the one who comes out on top, whipping Roddy Piper into the corner and following it up with an elbow. Hogan then follows this up with two body slams and an elbow drop on Piper. Hulk Hogan may be big, Hulk Hogan may be strong, but Hulk Hogan has to be one of the dumbest idiots to ever lace up a pair of boots. The first time the WWF champion whipped his challenger into the corner worked, but Roddy Piper is no regular competitor. Hot Rod is so intelligent that he recognizes patterns before they're even happening. So when Hulk Hogan tries to go for it a second time, Roddy Piper is ready and reverses it into a clothesline and a sleeper. The Hulkster is almost lifeless at this point of the match, but manages to summon the last of his strength, thanks in large part to the animals in the crowd, ramming Rowdy Roddy Piper into the corner in an effort to escape the sleeper. The Scotsman is infuriated, dragging Hulk Hogan's face across the ropes, and when that moronic referee interferes, Bob Orton takes over with devastating results. Hulk Hogan puts those 24-inch pythons to use, hitting Roddy Piper with a clothesline. Just as this happens, Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, makes an appearance and relieves the injured Bob Orton. But even this isn't enough to distract Hulk Hogan, who goes on to deliver an atomic drop to Hot Rod. Again though, Hulk Hogan is intellectually inferior and yet again follows the Tony Atlas example of going to the well one too many times, attempting a second atomic drop, but Piper responds with a punch. There goes the referee. It's time for some payback, as Rowdy Roddy Piper and Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff demonstrate tremendous teamwork as they go to work on the WWF champion. All's fair in love and the war to settle the score. What does this broad want now? Well, you've got the attention of two dangerous men now, lady. Good luck. Security, Mr. T is posing a danger to himself and the wrestlers in the ring. Ah, to hell with those dopes that call themselves security guards. Go ahead, Mr. T, move Cyndi Lauper out of harm's way. It's time for you to learn that a wrestling ring is no place for an actor to be.
Listen to this.
Look at these two, Piper doesn't know what to do.
Wait a minute.
Now security is involved and the cops? You know, I think the NWA made a song that exemplifies my feelings perfectly here, and I am not talking about the National Wrestling Alliance. This is horrible! Not only do Piper, Orton, and Orndorff barely escape the fuzz, but the WWF champion Hulk Hogan is proclaimed winner by disqualification. You may have won the war to settle the score, Hulk Hogan, but we who are vanquished will not go quietly into the night. Back in the locker room, Mean Gene Okerlund is standing by with Alan Hunter. Some of you old-timers may remember him as being a video jockey for MTV between 1981 and 1987. I only know this because he's so irrelevant to my generation that I had no choice but to Google him. Hunter says that due to the WWF champion winning by disqualification, the war to settle the score didn't really settle anything, before going on to exclaim how excited he was that Mr. T got involved.
Mr. T was certainly a big surprise this evening that he showed up, but I'm glad he did in the nick of time.
So you're advocating fans jumping the rail and attacking wrestlers. Did I hear that right, Alan? Here comes the top goof of this troop, the WWF champion himself. Hulk Hogan saw the devil in Rowdy Roddy Piper's eyes, but not even Satan's power was enough to vanquish the Rock and Wrestling Connection. Look, man, he's just Scottish, not a demon. Cyndi Lauper and her man-child of a boyfriend, David Wolfe, are Mean Gene Okerlund's next guests, man. And, you know, David Wolfe is just, like, totally excited at what happened, man. David Wolfe will be damned if Roddy Piper ever gets one over on his girlfriend and Hulk Hogan.
And that, I don't know what you call that, that's not a bodyguard, that's half a man there with half an arm.
Whoa. You keep Cowboy Bob Orton's name out of your filthy mouth, Cindy. And you know what? It's great that you don't care what happens to yourself in the ring, and you'll go to your friend's defense no matter what. Tell me, how's that head feeling after Roddy Piper kicked it in? Mr. T, who the NYPD really should have been gunning for earlier, comes into the locker room like he owns the place. This guy just reeks of arrogance before going on to say how much of a fan he is of wrestling in a shameful attempt to win over the single IQ idiots that occupy Madison Square Garden's audience before going on to call Rowdy Roddy Piper.
I think there's a chump and a sissy who gotta hit a lady, you know.
Anytime you need me, I'll be there, brother.
Well,
you my man, I think you're the greatest heavy wrestler ever been, man.
Like I said, Hulk Hogan was the top goof of this troupe. Because we're not done yet. Captain Loser Albano tries to remain relevant despite the fact that he has two victorious WWF Tag Team Champions to gloat about, wearing WWF Championship gold instead, like he has any right to do so. I'd love to tell you what Captain Albano said, but he was screaming so incoherently that all I could make out was
Cindy Lauper, champion Hulk Hogan,
before he had to be escorted out of the room and hopefully to a psych ward.
Please.
Fine. I thank you very much, Captain Lou Albano. A little lower profile.
Huh? What the hell is that? Oh, it's just Andy Warhol. He was speechless at what took place tonight. And he might as well have been speechless during this interview with Mean Gene Okerlund, considering the guy just mumbled his way through it.
It's just so exciting, I just don't know what to say.
Talk about your outdated and irrelevant 80s actors. It's Joe Piscopo, everyone, famous for such movie roles as bit part in 1976's King Kong.
I have the Hulk sweat on me, I'm very excited. He dripped on me on the way out and I thought it was pretty hot. When the girls got wrestling, that was pretty hot.
This creep's a certified weirdo. Billy Squire, Danny DeVito. These are just a couple more celebrities that have a word with Mean Gene Okerlund before Rowdy Roddy Piper enters the locker room, demanding to be interviewed by Okerlund, who outright refuses.
Dress up if you're gonna come on.
Dress
this
up,
is
I don't have to, I can do exactly what I wanna do. The only way this guy, Danny, the only way this guy holds it.
Piper doesn't need a hack like Mean Gene Okerlund to interview him anyway. He can walk the walk and he can talk the talk, so talk Hot Rod does, and outright states that WWF Champion doesn't have the guts to face off against Piper one-on-one again.
I am the champion, you know that for a fact,
Piper,
man.
Millions and millions of people
so
here on
what?
MTV, you
Did
know
they
what
they see him pin me?
And since that's the case, the Hulkster may as well just hand the WWF Championship over to Hot Rod right now.
I apologize, Roddy Piper, and Danny.
That guy was wet, wasn't he?
The war to settle the score didn't settle anything, according to Alan Hunter. He might be right, especially considering how the night ended with Rowdy Roddy Piper challenging Hulk Hogan to a rematch for the WWF Championship. Will the Hulkster be brave enough to go back into the trenches now that he's won a tainted victory? Only time will tell. Thanks for tuning in to another special episode of Tyler Vance Rants. Don't forget to settle the score with good pro wrestling content by hitting the bell, liking the video, and subscribing. And you can also follow me on social media, where it is 1985 and pro wrestling all over again. That's all for now. So long. The Rock and Wrestling Connection is in full swing. Oh, I did those hand gestures. Sky uses Wendy Richter, blah, 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 blah. Jabs her hand into Wendy Richter's throat. A back suplex could have spelt doom for Moondog Rex. However, he was close enough to avoid disaster. Close enough to what? And he puts those 24-inch somethings.